Hey team, alright. So we are going to jump into the amniotes, and then we're also going to talk about the reptiles. And then in the next video, we're going to hit the mammals, and then we are done with animal diversity. So we are still in tetrapods, we're still talking about vertebrates, we're still in phylum chordata. But now I want to talk about these two groups right here, reptiles and mammals, which include the birds that are what we call amniotes. Okay, but what does that mean, an amniote? So amniotes are a clade of tetrapods that have eggs that are uniquely adapted for living on land. So if we remember when we talked about the amphibians, they have to return to some sort of water or be in some sort of moist environment in order to lay their eggs so they don't dry out. So the amniotes, the reptiles, birds, and mammals, their eggs have an extra layers around them that protect them from drying out, which allows them to live in more environments, a greater diversity of environments compared to the amphibians. So there's two clades again within the amniotes, the reptiles, which includes the birds, and then the mammals. So we're going to talk about what an amniotic egg is, and then we're going to talk about reptiles. So the amniotes, these are eggs that have extra embryonic membranes that are surrounding the embryo. So these are not actually part of the embryo, these are derived from the maternal tissue. But they help to protect the embryo, cushion the embryo, and then function in gas exchange, waste storage, and the transfer of nutrients. So if we look at the amniotic egg, here we go, here's kind of a generic amniotic egg. We see here's the actual embryo itself. Okay, and then it's surrounded by this amniotic cavity, so it's the amniotic fluid. That's basically its self-contained pond, if you will, inside of that amniotic cavity, so that way it doesn't dry out. Then we have even more extra embryonic membranes outside of that. So outside of the amniotic cavity, we see the allantois. This is a membrane that functions in waste disposal. Okay, so getting rid of any sort of metabolic waste that the embryo is producing, it has to be disposed of. So this is what the allantois does. We have the yolk right here, and organisms that have free standing eggs, so eggs that are not retained inside of the mother, the yolk is what provides all of the nutrition for that embryo right there. Okay. This layer right here, the chorion. Okay, this functions in gas exchange. So this is somewhat permeable to air, but drastically less so than the amphibian egg. And so this chorion helps to exchange, get rid of waste gases from the embryo, and then bring in oxygen that the embryo needs to continue to develop. And this amniotic, excuse me, this amnion fluid right here, this amnion, what would be an egg white in an egg? Its main purpose is to protect against mechanical shock. So typically, this entire thing is going to be covered in some sort of shell, either a hard calcium carbonate shell in birds, or in a more flexible shell in reptiles. And then the amnion provides protection if that egg moves around. It's a shock absorber for that embryo because that embryo is very fragile as it's developing. We'll see in mammals are amniotes. They do have these extra embryonic layers, but they've now taken that structure and they've internalized it. Okay, so no, most mammals don't have a shell to this amniotic egg. But again, the main purpose of this amniotic egg, why this is such a big deal when we're talking about the evolution of amniotes and of chordates specifically, is that this egg allows these organisms, these reptiles, birds, and mammals, to reproduce away from water. And that opens up whole new territories that they can now exploit and live in. So typically, in birds, they have a calcium carbonate egg, so it's inflexible. And partly the reason why that is because they are endothermic, so they maintain their own body temperature. And that also means that they have to maintain the body temperature. They have to keep those eggs warm as well. Okay. And so if you sit on an egg that's squishy, like a reptile egg that's soft, birds can't sit on that. They would crush it and it would basically collapse under them. So they have a hard calcium carbonate egg, so that way they can keep it warm, so that way they can keep the body temperature of the embryo up. Most reptile eggs are flexible. They're not that hard calcium carbonate that we see in the birds. And most mammals and some reptiles also have lost the shell, and the embryo is going to avoid drying out by remaining inside of the mother for its development. We see this in some reptiles as well, so we call oviparity, if they keep the egg inside of the mother and then the egg hatches inside and looks like live birth. Or true what we call viviparity, which is true live birth. There's no eggshell. That's basically been replaced by the placenta and transferred nutrients and maintaining of moisture is transferred through the mother. So this is what makes this amniotic egg such a big deal. It allows them to exist away from water, to reproduce away from water. But tied into that amniotic egg, we see some other key traits of these amniotes. The skin of amniotes is now less permeable to water. So that's good and bad. It prevents desiccation, but it also means that they can no longer gas exchange across their skin like amphibians can. We see now, so because they can no longer gas exchange across their skin, they have a more muscular rib cage that allows for ventilation of the lungs. So a lot of amphibians have to basically gulp air with their throat muscles. But now in amniotes, we see muscles in the rib cage help to expand that rib cage and then provide a negative pressure so that way the air will fill the lungs with. And most amniotes typically display more elevated and upright stature compared to amphibians, which is more efficient for walking on land. So more of your energy is going towards moving forward when you're standing upright as opposed to moving side to side when you're a little more crouched down like that. So those are general amniote characteristics. Let's talk real quick about what reptiles, some of the key characteristics of reptiles. So reptiles are amniotes. They're vertebrates and they're tetrapods. One of their key adaptations, one of the first things that we see, is they now have scales. We don't see scales on amphibians, and these scales are made of keratin, the protein keratin, same protein that's in your fingernails or in your hair, and it serves as a waterproof barrier, so that way they won't desiccate when they're in dry environments. But again, that prevents them from breathing or gas exchanging through their skin, so now they have to rely on their lungs, and that's what the muscular rib cage allows them to do. Most reptiles are going to lay their eggs, their amniotic eggs, on land. They're the first group to do so, to reproduce on land without water. Their fertilization is internal now because of this. Because they're reproducing away from water, they now have internal fertilization because they don't have that medium anymore. Okay. Some reptiles are viviparous, meaning that they retain the entire embryo inside, and they do have some sort of structure analogous to a placenta in mammals that provides nutrients to the growing embryo. Okay, and we also see what's called oviparity, which is kind of an old term, it's not really used anymore, but that's a similar idea where the egg is retained inside of the mother. There might be some transfer nutrients, and then the live young is given birth to. So reptiles, they're adapted to land because they have watertight skin. They have amniotic eggs, and they have thoracic breathing. They can use their lungs, they can use their rib cage to expand their lungs, okay? So they're not gulping air through their throat like we see in the amphibians. So reptiles are ectothermic, which means that they do not use their body temperature, they do not use their metabolism to regulate their body temperature. So because they aren't using their metabolism, the food that they eat to maintain a constant body temperature, they can use way few calories than endothermic animals can. So about reptiles can exist on about 10% of the energy of an endothermic animal. But they do regulate their body temperature within a pretty close range, a pretty tight range, but they do it behaviorally. So they're going to alter where they're at, if they need to be in the sun, if they need to be in the shade, depending on how they need to regulate their body temperature. Okay. However, even though birds are part of the reptile clade, birds are endothermic. And there is some evidence that some dinosaurs were endothermic as well. So meaning that they do use their metabolism to maintain their body temperature. And we'll talk about some of the advantages of that when we dive into birds and mammals. So here's our reptile clade, a phylogeny of reptile clade. So the ancestral amniote being this ancestor, common ancestor right here, kind of diverged first into two groups, the synapsids, which gave rise to the mammals, and then within the reptile clade, we have two, the diapsids, which are the group that are still around today. It diverged into the archosaurs, which include the crocodilians and potentially the turtles, as well as most of what we know as the classic dinosaurs, and then also the birds. So the birds are part of the archosaur clade. On the other side of this right here, we have the lepidosaurs. So the lepidosaurs are where we get the squamates, which are the snakes and lizards. And the tuatara which are the lizard-like organisms that are very rare, that are found in parts of New Zealand. Okay, so this is our general phylogeny of reptiles. So all dinosaurs, all members of this clade right here, including the pterosaurs, they all went extinct around 65 million years ago on the KT boundary. There is some evidence that they were social, that they were endothermic, we also don't really know why they went extinct. There's some evidence that they had been declining in their populations and their species numbers for several million years before that asteroid impact that most people think caused their extinction. But the asteroid, that impact of the asteroid of that KT boundary, is really the delineation of before and after dinosaurs. So we think that the asteroid probably changed the climate enough and altered things enough that it hastened the extinction of these already declining species. But many other species, many other animals survived. So there are some remaining reptiles of the dinosaur clade, including birds. So birds are the only remaining dinosaurs that are left, as well as other reptiles, and then mammals survived the impact. Okay. So here's our major groups of reptiles. So this is the Tuatara that we're talking about. It kind of reminds me of an iguana, but it's not. Again, these are very rare, and they're mostly found around New Zealand. Snakes, which are legless lizards, in the squamates group, and then actual lizards, which are also in the squamates group. So snakes and lizards are very closely related. Snakes have just secondarily lost their legs, which we talked about when we talked about evolution and vestigial traits. And then we have the crocodilians and alligators. These are a really ancient group. And what's interesting about the crocodilians and alligators, some of them have an analogous structure like a diaphragm. So we have an additional structure under our rib cage that we can, additional muscle or diaphragm that we can pull down to help ventilate our lungs. And crocodilians and alligators have something similar to that, but it's more they're pulling their entire liver downwards. Okay. And then we have the turtles and tortoises, where they have fused their rib cage into a shell, and that shell allows them for immense protection, and it's not really clear how exactly they breathe, because that shell also minimizes any sort of expansion of their rib cage that they would have. Okay. So birds are also in the reptile clade, but we're going to talk about them separately because they have many unique adaptations that are completely different than what we see in the reptiles.